This is the second chapter of the second book, Politics of India Since Independence, and here we study about planning and development, the early ideas of development in India, the formation of the National Development Council, the various 5-year plans, and finally the recently established Niti Aayog. Let us first discuss about the issues of development in the early years of independence. First, we talk about the issue of the controversial issue of supporting one social group versus supporting the other social group. These social groups could refer to, on one hand, the elite group or the already established capitalists who were working under the British government as well, to focus on them so that they could grow better and provide a better framework to the Indian economy, or rather to focus on the rest of the roughly 85% of the weaker sections of the society who were more or less agriculturally based. The second issue of development was to focus on the present development so that the future of the country could also be ensured. A balance between the present generation and the future generation had to be maintained. A controversy or a balance had to be established between economic growth and social growth. On one hand, we had to focus on building up the GDP of the country, or to build up the infrastructure of the country, or to build up the basic framework of the country, versus do we focus on the social aspects of the country, like poverty eradication, or say employment growth, or say educating the society, or providing better health facilities. So there was an issue ki what should India be focusing on. An economic growth was more essential than the social growth, or the social aspect was more essential than the economic growth. We also needed to understand that the whatever balance growth that we frame out, it had to be ensuring justice to all sections of the society. We couldn't afford one section of the society growing while the other, on the other hand, the other suffering. We also had to go by the preamble of the constitution, where social, economic and political justice had to be ensured to basically all the sections of the society. So, what we also needed to do was to come in terms with all political parties, so that all political parties could agree to a common benchmark of development, so that all of us could work together to developing the nation that we had always dreamt of. The next aspect that we need to discuss is, eventually we formed a council, a group, a National Development Council, or as we call it, is the Rashtriya Vikas Parishad. Vikas, as we know, refers to the term development, and it was specifically a body, a top body, top level body, which was assigned the task to deliberate or discuss on developmental matters, on the issues. The controversies that were just referred to had been discussed and debated in this council. It was established in 6th August 1952 specifically to strengthen and mobilize the effort and resources of the country, so that the resources could be used for framing the 5-year plans. The 5-year plans in turn were to be framed by another commission called the Planning Commission. Basically, the basic idea of both of these was to promote common economic policies in vital spheres so that rapid and balanced development could be ensured to the entire nation at large. We also must understand that the growth had to take place eventually in all the states that constituted this newly formed India. With this in mind, we move on to the idea of development that we first thought about, or we were thinking about. So the National Development Council had various thought processes working together. Some of them had a Western idea of development that wanted to focus basically on industrialization, point number one. Industrialization, and that too, how to multiply the profits of these industries, and that would be possible only because of modernization. So the initial aspect was to help industries grow, to focus on research so that more profits could take place. The fact that industries had always given a better growth rate as compared to agriculture was more lucrative to a newly developed country and for its government also. Along with the with this aspect, we had the other task of breaking down the traditional social structures. We just studied, we had an issue called justice to all sections of society, an all-round aspect of it. That justice could be ensured only when all the sections of the society were treated to be equal. The fact that even long before independence also, since times immemorial or the Vedic ages, we find the Indian society had always been divided between those who were considered the backward class and those who were considered the forward class. So this difference had been there for times immemorial, and Gandhiji long before independence had insisted that India would never progress till such time as these sections of the society were brought into the forefront. Now with this basic ideal in mind, we had framed the constitution, and now the economy also had to be developed on the same lines. So in order to help break this traditional social structure, the economy had to be framed in a likewise fashion. So we find to a certain extent a rise of capitalism and liberalism in the country, a focus on growth, material progress specifically relates to more profits, a more better bank balance, a more better GDP, along with scientific rationality. Scientific rationality was very close to Nehru's policies. He always insisted on use of science and reason to develop the country's basic infrastructure. Besides, we also needed to focus at the task of poverty alleviation, where 85% of the population included the have-nots, those who did not have either wealth or status or education or employment or all those social factors that define the nation. Hence, if you broadly classify, the idea of development was between agriculturist and industrialized world, between liberal capitalist model and the socialist model. So let us now focus on another aspect of this. One includes the capitalist or the free market economy versus the command economy or the communist economy. While we'll first focus on the capitalist model, where we see the people determine everything. The people are supreme. So we see capitalism is merged with liberalism or democracy. The basic motive, there is the provision of private property. There is more of competition. The government's influence in economy is limited, though initially in India we find a lot of government's influence in it. Nevertheless, we say a capitalist world has very limited governmental interference. Freedom, both of individual and the society, is valued. More of the individual is valued. And there are innovations, inventions taking place. In a communist economy, we find everything is government controlled. There is private property which is not encouraged, or we might say there is very limited private property. Competition does not arise because we believe in a socialist model where everyone is equal. The government influence on the economy is tremendous. Regulations are enforced by the government. And people also lack incentives. Because you are growing collectively, so you share both the profits and the losses collectively. So let's begin with where did we actually start the deploying process, and we might as well focus on in the year 1944, where a joint proposal was initiated by the industrialists who settled for a planned economy in the country. Long before India got independence, in Bombay, the industrialists had decided that we need to have a very planned structure of the economy, where the state or the government should take up the initiative of industrial and economic investment, because money in private hands was limited to roughly 10-15% of the population. So the onus for development had to be taken up by the government. Yani, we are expecting a mixture of what we just studied, a capitalist and a communist model. So that's the five-year plan initially presented with rupees 2069 crore outlay for various projects to build up the nation's wealth. The early initiatives include: a five-year document was laid down. Now, there are two aspects to planning that takes place. One is the one-year annual plans, as we call as the budget, and the other initiatives that we undertake is the five-year or the long-term planning that we focus on. The long-term planning was meant for the entire nation, that would be fulfilled on or gauged on an annual basis and collectively after the end of 5 years, where the Prime Minister was supposed to be the ex officio chairman. He had experts from the cabinet rank, from the planning commission, which formed the planning commission. Now, Nehru's idea of planning included: this is the first planning commission that you see, where discussions take place among the various political parties and the educated economists of the country. So the planning commission was set up in March 1950 with the object to promote a better standard of living, to efficiently use the Indian resources and to utilize it for the increasing population, and to offer opportunities for employment for all. Jawaharlal Nehru was the first chairman of the planning commission, and he had to balance the resources versus the priorities at that point of time. The initial functions of the planning commission therefore include: maximize output; second, a vision for the future; third, to set targets as per various sections, the agricultural, the service sector or the industrial sector; and then to develop a holistic approach to the formulation of policies in critical areas like human development, besides the economy of the country. The first five-year plan, between 1951 and 56, we have the first five-year plan. This five-year plan was laid down by Mr. K.N. Raj, and he advised, "Let us hasten." Hasten means quick, but at a slow pace. Why? Because this fast pace of development would endanger democracy. If we run after quick progress, we might be able not to cover up the large, poorer sections of the society. And if we are too slow, the industrial development would also lag behind. So we need to be quick enough, but not without carrying all the sections of the society with us. We need to bring the economy out of poverty, the first aspect. How do we do it? So we tried to balance the model of a capitalist world and a communist world. So we had a mixed economy taking place. A mixed economy meaning, in certain sectors the government would interfere where large investments were required, where people did not have money to invest in such large projects. Also, in projects which were not profitable by nature, the government decided that we would interfere and we would invest in these issues. These were basically social in aspect, like establishing of schools or say projects. On the other hand, it also gave leverage to those industrialists who were ready and willing to invest in areas, or who had the potential to or potential in terms of money to invest in areas of development, growth and industrialization. So the government invested in dams, irrigation projects, especially the Bhakra Nangal. There has been cooperation from the side of USSR at that point of time, as we already studied. The land reforms were undertaken, where redistribution of land was to be organized, where the national income was to be raised and more savings were to be promoted on behalf of the population of the people. Once more savings come up, the government had more funds to invest. If it had more funds to invest, it could lead to more growth and development across the country. So the first five-year plan had the basic object to improve the living standards of the people, to use India's natural resources effectively. And the target for the initial the growth rate was 2.1% per year. What was achieved? This is important. The GDP grew well. We achieved our targets. We had built up a number of irrigation projects across the country that included Mettur Dam, Hirakud and Bhakra. We had rehabilitated the landless workers and had given them occupation in the various dam building projects, or had given them areas where they could work as agriculturists. The second focus was on soil conservation, so that better output could be ensured from the very fields that we had. What we needed to do was, we could not change everything miraculously. What could be done was to conserve the soil to help have better productivity. Another stream that we chose on was to improve the infrastructure in terms of transport and communication. Improve the post and telegraph lines that were already laid by the British, though a certain amount of investment was made in this behalf. But what was undertaken was repair and progress in these areas. Railway lines, road tracks, civil aviations were focused on. Sufficient funds were allocated for industrial sector as well, specifically the small scale industries. Likewise, that's the structure where the allocation of funds is seen. More of it is invested in transport and communication in both the 5-year plans, that initial 2 5-year plans. Now, the second in line comes up with agriculture and irrigation facilities. A small bit of it was also invested in social services as well. And though the first 5-year plan we see invests very little in industries, the second 5-year plan will focus on industries and on a larger scale. So let's see what's the second 5-year plan focusing on. Its creator, P.C. Mahalanobis, and what we need to study was the structural transformation of the country was now required. The first 5-year plans did not bring about a very miraculous change in the economy of the country. We had focused on agriculture, but the targets were not as good as we had believed, because the progress was slow, the change was difficult to manage, land distribution, redistribution, allocation, the dams were still under progress. So the results or the outputs were not very miraculous. So it was essential that now, after 5 years of independence, of 5 years of planning, it was essential that something that would give us very quick returns had to be focused on. So looking at the criticisms of the first 5-year plan, where the industrialists cribbed about government not focusing on the industrial sector, plus a lower bank balance and savings, because the poor agriculturists hadn't progressed so well to give large huge savings. So the only option was to focus now on industrialists who might be able to save more and then later on invest more. So the structural transformation was required in all directions. At the Awadhi session of the Congress in Madras, we openly declared India to have a socialist pattern as the goal of society. Socialist pattern did not mean that we have adopted the communist model for the entire country. It was only as far as the societal development was concerned that we were more socialist focused on the workers, the peasants, the working class, the overall poverty alleviation or agricultural development of the country. If we had to focus on industries, we had to protect our growing newborn country industries that had been established or were being established. So what best part was to protect? This is where the license regime has its initial beginning, where we impose tariffs on imports. Goods from abroad could not be brought into India. They were huge. There was a huge amount of taxes that were imposed on it, so that the domestic industries could be protected. They were not so strong in terms of quality and the price. So in order to protect the domestic industries as compared to the products of the Western world, we had to protect our industries, which were raw, which were still not polished, still not well researched. So we imposed a tariff to protect our domestic industries. We protected the industrial environment to help both the public as well as the private industries. So the second five-year plan was focused on consumption goods as well as capital goods. We had a growth in the savings here, which led to the establishment of industries like electricity, railway, steel. Railway and steel were the most progressive of all the industries that were focused in the second five-year plan. Technological procurement also was also focused on, but because we focused on industries, our food shortages again occurred in this term of 5 years. And the second five-year plan has been criticized for having an urban bias, because the industries or the major industries or the infrastructure were located basically in the big cities, and hence the rural section was sidelined in this regard. This is in continuation with chapter 2. We were talking about planning and development, and we considered two issues to be the most controversial in the entire episode, and that being the controversy as to whether to pick up agriculture as the main sector where economy had to be planned and developed, or to pick up industries as the main sector that has to be planned and developed. While Chaudhary Charan Singh focused on agriculture to be the basic stream that the Indians should be focusing on, J.C. Kumarappa emphasized on rural industrialization. On the lines of Mahatma Gandhi, he focused that since India, most 90% of India lies in its villages, what needs to be promoted is, besides agriculture, is rural industrialization. Small-scale industries, their growth and development had to be focused on. So, between the controversies, let us look into what angle did these thinkers, viewers think. The second five-year plan had already focused on industries, leaving agriculture again on the sidelines. The prosperity of the urban industrial section of the society irritated the farmers and the rural population, who said that non-focusing on agriculture had led to a food crisis in the country. So what was to be managed was a proper balance between agricultural and the industrialization process. While the industrialists emphasized that focusing on industrialization as an important aspect of economy was essential, because that was the quickest and the easiest way to move out from the cycle of poverty, looking that more industrialization would lead to more employment opportunities and a shift from the loading of people seeking money out of agriculture into industrial sector. So more workers would be getting employed here. So between this controversy, there was also the program for community development that had to be introduced, where law and reforms will be introduced, where there shall be redistribution of resources, consolidation of land holdings that would soon take place, as the suggestion went in. Most important, the land reforms would also suffer in the long run because of the rich zamindars who had political affiliations as well as a protection that they received via the right to property, wherein they will oppose implementation of land reforms at a wider angle. So looking at it from the other angle, where the controversy rises between the public sector and the private sector, we've already tried to understand the concept how Nehru planned for a mixed economy, a model that was both a mix of capitalism and communism, where agriculture, trade and industry would be left in private hands, and the state would help to control or manage the key heavy industries where huge capital and investment were required, or to lay the foundation of a better infrastructure for the country. To protect the private industries, it set up the license regime, or what we call as regulation of trade, where crucial intervention by the government was required. Through the system of license and permits, it shielded the nave, the raw industries that did not have to then face competition from abroad and could sell out their products in whatever be its क्वालिटी वॉट एवर बी इट्स आउटपुट पॉजिटिवली इट डिड मेड द इंडस्ट्रियल सेक्टर प्रोग्रेसिव सिक्योर एंड एबल टू डेवलप एंड ग्रो. ऑन दी अदर हैंड इफ यू लुक इट फ्रॉम द हाइंडसाइड फेसिंग नो कॉम्पिटिशन मेंट देर वॉज नो अटेम्प्ट टू मेक द प्रोडक्ट्स बेटर नो इंसेंटिव्स देम टू मेक इट no incentives to, or motivation to have a better quality product, more invest more on research, more so it never made those goods cheaper which could have been made in case the products from outside were in competition with the Indian ones. State control also led to inefficiency and corruption within the system as well as with the bureaucracy of the nation. What prevailed then was what we often refer to as the red tapism. State also, if it was investing more on infrastructure or say in agriculture and industry, had little to invest in education, healthcare facilities, or the so-called social welfare schemes, which was most required at that point of time. Nevertheless, a new middle class is emerging. Those that have actually progressed or have taken advantage of the irrigational schemes or the agricultural production that has increased, and this class shall become the new middle class for the Indian society. Of the entire outcomes of the 3-5 year plans, if we effectively see it, the land reforms were proposed but not implemented. Political affiliations with the rich class prevented the actual implementation at the groundwork. The rich-poor gap did not reduce, though it had become a lot more less than it used to be in the year 47, but still the marginal difference was very limited looking at the population growth as well. So the building of mega dams for irrigation and power generation led to more employment opportunities, definitely. Infrastructure development, most important, and also sought in to provide more job opportunities as well. Heavy industries like steel, oil, or say production of the defense equipments and heavy industries were set up, which gave in more employment as well. Infrastructure in transport and communication also started. The land reforms that were proposed to be introduced were abolition of the zamindari system, consolidation of land so that those small farm holdings could be mixed into a viable unit where mechanization could take place, where modernization could take place, better farming equipments could be used. For the rich landowning class, a ceiling was to be fixed as to the amount of land that they could have. Ceiling means a limit on the amount of land that they could possess. For the tenants or those who did not own property but worked on the farms of the other people, there was legal security given to them so that they could at least avail of the benefits of the farm produce that they actually gave him. One drawback of the entire reform policy was the zoning policy that was introduced. As there was more of food shortages because of drought famine conditions across the country and specifically North India, the government introduced zoning policies, that meaning the farmers of UP could not trade with, for example, could not trade with people in Bihar. So what happened was the movement of food products was inhibited. There were different reasons with the government so that in search of better prices, UP might not get into a crisis was the main policy why zoning was introduced. But eventually what actually happened was if Bihar was more in need of farm produce and it did not get, there was a severe food crisis happening in Bihar. So with all good intentions, there was the negative impact of the entire land reform policy that was being taking place across the country. So looking at this and the early 60s where where the green revolution is supposed to be taking place. We have an American economist. We have an American economist, Norman Borlaug, who introduced green revolution abroad, and his policies were implemented in India by M.S. Swaminathan. To overcome the food crisis in India and to make India more stable and viably agricultural, a policy was to be put in place focusing in on one, North India, focusing or keeping in mind those farmers who had established themselves or who were more comfortable, so that the government only had to focus on increasing the farm production through better equipments, pesticides, fertilizers, high quality seeds. So with the focus on already well-off farmers in selected areas on selected crops, a better produce so that the food crisis could be averted is what we call as the Green Revolution, which eventually did lead to a better food availability in the country. The situation arose because India had to import almost 10 million tons of food, specifically wheat, for 2 years, leading to more loans and debts to be paid. So, with improved management techniques, the Green Revolution comes into full sway in roughly mid-60s. The Green Revolution, introduced by Norman Borlaug and the father of Green Revolution in India, Swaminathan, who wanted to introduce the high-yielding variety of crops, specifically wheat in India. The basic elements included three basic features. One, to expand the farming area in the country. Instead of one crop in 1 year, we could have double cropping in 1 year. One crop to be irrigated based on natural monsoon, and the other to be irrigated using artificial irrigation methods like water from the dams, etc. The third example was to improve, the third angle was to improve the quality of seeds available in India, and once the seeds have germinated, to protect the seeds from getting caught in the maze of pests and other flaws. So what we need to understand is, with the three issues in mind, and dams being built, better irrigation techniques, better quality seeds, we managed to finally introduce pesticides, farming machinery, tractors, electric pumps, and the quality of farm produce and the amount of yield doubled. This had its various advantages, which include better economic results. Besides more production, higher yields and yields, it also led to more job opportunities. Fertilizers as industries, pesticide industry, fungicide industry, chemical industries, local manufacturing units all grew up as allied to agricultural industries. It also led to dam building also led to hydroelectric production, making India energy sufficient and providing electricity to the remote corners of the world, and quality of life at the village level improved. With more yields, India was able to repay the World Bank loans and also improve its creditworthiness. Punjab and Haryana most prospered because of the Green Revolution, and which also led to Canada demanding trained agricultural farmers from India, as it had a shortage of agricultural labor. And that also explains why many of the Indians, specifically from the Punjab Haryana area, are to be found as Canadian residents today. Sociologically, we find more creation of factories or plenty of jobs as alternate means of earning. Politically, more production meant the GDP going up, and net effect having on Indira Gandhi, who actually because of land reforms and a few channel changes, managed to win the next elections. The drawbacks of the entire revolution include, because we already started with focusing on already rich peasants whose yield had to be only multiplied. That meaning beneficiaries were only the rich peasants and the large landholders where mechanization could actually take place. It focused only on Punjab, Haryana and West UP. The other areas of northern India remained backward. Now, increased polarization thereby, the difference or the rich poor gap not only increased between classes but also between regions. Hence, a term which normally is used with called the Bimaru states occurred, where we find small other states actually diminished in their economic output. So the contrast between the poor peasantry and the landlords also led to more revolutions coming in, where left wing organizations increased pressure on the government to help the poor peasantry class, and also side by side led to what we later will study on Naxalite movements. The middle class had already emerged by now as a proper class in India. Besides the Green Revolution, you have the White Revolution related to the milk and milk production. Verghese Kurien actually started it, what we normally know as the Operation Flood or Amul, since 1917. 1967, Indira Gandhi introduced a few reforms. She nationalized 14 banks to improve on inefficiency and corruption in various areas. The bureaucracy was more stabilized, though economic conditions were depleting, but the focus was on better environment and improving the economic conditions in the country. While these changes were taking place, the current day planning and development has taken a U-turn with the introduction of Niti Aayog in place of the planning commission that we just studied about, which was apt during early independence stages, is no longer relevant to the 21st century. Looking at the fact that 1991 was a benchmark year for a change in the Indian economy, where the world had moved into liberalization, privatization and globalization, the old socialist model of the planning commission was no longer relevant. In order to cope with such changes and the pressing needs of development taking place, 2015 saw the setting up of Niti Aayog by the Prime Minister, the announcement being in 2014. The main object was to create a forum which would technically advise the Union government into making policies both for the centre and the state governments. The Prime Minister is the ex officio chairman, but the Prime Minister also appoints a vice chairman. Mr. Arvind was the first vice chairman of the Niti Aayog, and the president being Mr. Dr. Rajiv Kumar. It aims to harmonize the interests of national security. For the first time, planning includes, besides the socio-economic development, military and strategic planning also. So the three wings have been aligned: economy, society and military have been organized or harmonized in the Niti Aayog. It still frames long-term policies and programs. It is the think tank of the Union government, where the approach is to introduce federalism to a large extent. Federalism meaning cooperation between the center and the state, which is easily termed as cooperative federalism, the bottom-up approach, where interaction between the center and the state becomes at an equal level, also to bring about the weaker sections of the society at par with the rest of the country. The Niti Aayog is progressing well. What remains is to see the federal approach being more successful as compared to the former times. That's it for the chapter.